everybody, it's Lynn from WisconsinGarden.com, and today we're going to go on an early June garden tour. Things are just bursting open and it just smells so good. We just had to share what was going on in the garden. Some of you have been asking about how our iris are doing. I'd say they're quite happy. And they're opening just in time for Rick's birthday as a special present.
Oh, I love that grape Kool-Aid smell.
Yep.
Absolutely delicious. And they look very healthy.
They are very healthy and very full. Even the ones that were transplanted early this spring are grabbing right on. I see I've got a couple of weeds to pull there, but very happy and smells so good.
Like your little birdhouse.
Isn't it a beauty? Did we get that at a rummage sale?
I think so.
This is a shady area. I have put in some elephant ear bulbs. We'll see if they come up. They were ones that I saved over the winter. Lots of hostas over here. Sometimes we use this as our deer catcher one, because at some points this one they have chewed on, but the rest they leave. So this is our sacrificial hosta sometimes. This is our experimental grape arbor that we've had for years. We always said we were going to trim it back and keep it trimmed. Well, Rick finally got to it this year and he really did a wholehearted job, and I think we're getting some nice growth off of it. It'll be interesting to see if we have grapes, although it kind of looks like we do right here, starting.
Yep.
After touring in California in the wine country, and every time we see a movie that has grapes and we're always studying, how does that stem look? What are they doing? How are they trimming? So we'll see. I am so tall. Remember that big pile of leaf mulch and then we had bark dumped on top of that? We finally got to that too. It's amazing how much work we've gotten done. And then Rick wonders why he's so tired. All right, so last week we finished this. We moved these benches over so it'd give it a more finished look and kind of tell people, you know, don't drop anything at this point. He put in a bunch of squash and watermelon.
And cantaloupe,
right. And protected them for now, at least, and we're hoping they'll climb up and over. And nobody's nibbling on them, and you wouldn't even know that they were newly transplanted. They look really good. And then we even moved one of our poor little blueberries that had been in a pot in a semi-shade area, where it was even blossoming and developing blueberries in the semi-shade. That was just, you've done very well. And then you have to turn around, Rick, and look at our corner there.
Oh.
That is just amazing. These peonies are lovely. They've been here a long time. And there used to be a row of iris in front of them. Well, we moved those iris, but we missed one. And it looks very pretty right there. You did a good job.
I'm surprised at the variety on one plant where you have pink and white.
Well, I think that's how they come.
Or do
they start
fade?
Coming out and then they turn more of a white.
Hmm.
But the smell is absolutely wonderful. Just gorgeous. And then behind you, there's a red one that's not quite open yet. This one's always been a darker one. So this one's coming along.
To the road. And
but so often, we never get to this part of the yard, but it's nice to look at. And if you look down the fence line, there's a spruce tree, and then behind it is the willow bush that we moved there from the other end of the property, and it's just going crazy. It is, it's in its glory for sure.
Well, let's go back in there.
Okay. This is a variegated willow bush. All right. This is more or less the flower part. Not that it has a blossom or anything that I've ever seen, but this is the display you get in the spring. The ends are pink.
Taller than you.
It is. It truly is. It wasn't even in its original place. It wasn't. Hmm. During the rest of the year, if you trim it back, you get rid of the, obviously you get rid of the pink. But if you don't trim it back after it's gone through this, I mean, it's just going to take over. So it will be trimmed, but not until it's done. And then there is this raspberry patch.
That you thought you got rid of?
Yeah, that we tried so hard to put a couple of plants in here, and they just weren't taking. Well, they decided that they were just going to take their own good time. We will be having some raspberries this year. So that's nice. Thank you.
So your raspberry jungle returned.
It did. It did. But I'm really going to have to keep after it because it can, just cannot take over the whole place again.
Well, then it goes beyond your rhubarb.
Right. Which that can't happen. And then we have milkweed. Don't forget the milkweed, right?
Yeah. Amongst the weeds?
Amongst the weeds is milkweed, and we're saving that for the monarchs. Okay. Ooh, raspberries.
I mean, put this your hand next to
this. This is our rhubarb.
That's like an elephant here.
It is. It's very healthy, very happy. This is a good move for these guys, too, because they have their space, they have rich soil. And
what about that one down?
Yeah, that one down there, I don't know. I'm just looking at that now.
It looks kind of wilty.
Yeah, it looks kind of scrunchy. I don't know. That one does too. Well, we'll see. It may come out if it doesn't look nice. And then these are blackberries. I don't think we're going to get any blackberries this year. They're biennial, so they don't fruit on the first years. We weren't sure in the spring if these were
viable
from last year or what, but obviously we can take all of these down. They're not going to produce this year. These guys are going to produce next year. We have this Wigelia bush that we've had for years now. It is kind of in semi-shade. It is blossoming like it never has, but it obviously doesn't look real healthy. So I think once it's done blossoming, we'll probably chop it way back and let it start all over again. But it's a variegated leaf one, and it's very attractive for the whole summer. Daisies pop up everywhere. It's nice that you can just pull them out. Beautiful columbine. They too just kind of plant themselves wherever they feel like it.
All of this is columbine.
Well this is. This is not.
Oh, that isn't?
Nope.
I see spittles on here too.
Oh yeah, spit bugs. I'm not sure what this is. It's not a mint. We'll find out. It could be one of those campulas.
Campanula.
With if it's what I think it is, it has these beautiful blue bells that hang down.
Hmm.
And it does like to take over.
Well, we have a sign here. Canterbell? Canterbury?
Canterbury bells.
There you go.
Which is a campanella medium. Yep, and this is the blue one. This purple right here is, of course, wild geranium. But you can see the campanella that's here on the ground is spreading.
Looks like somebody was nesting or lying down in here. Mm-hmm. Kind of distorted the... And look at these. Wow. That's a beautiful iris.
Now, you know the story on these iris?
Yeah,
there's a bunch of them in there. Ooh, that's a gorgeous one.
Isn't that?
These were some that I had. I moved them. I got some from the Wilson Center that were going to be tossed away. They sat in a box the entire summer, right over there next to the garage. And I never got to plant them until the fall. And they just are wonderful. Now you see this, and you're seeing it everywhere right now. And you say, oh, is that gorgeous? And it does look gorgeous. But guess what? This is not phlox. This is Dame's Rocket. This is not good stuff. This is going to be pulled out this week before it goes to seed. It's just, it spreads like crazy. And that's why you see it in all the ditches in people's yard. We did not plant this here, so that's
okay, so explain to viewers, in case somebody, the difference between phlox and Dame's Rocket. How can you tell the difference?
Phlox. You spell phlox P-H-L-O-X. It's got five letters in it. And so you look at the number of petals on the flower. There are only four. If there were five, and if it were later in the season, it would be real phlox. This is not even related to phlox. It just happens that the flower looks similar. So this really has no smell. Real phlox is very fragrant.
And Dame has four letters. So that's how the...
No, Dame has five also.
Oh, does it?
D-A-M-E.
That's four.
D-A-M-E. Oh, it is four.
Yes.
I can't count anymore.
That's how you tell the difference. Four letters versus five letters.
Very good. Yes. Well, I had half of it right.
Yes.
Thank you for helping me. So,
would you like to count to 10?
Bad stuff? Mm-mm.
Backwards?
Bad stuff? No. Phlox with a P-H is the good stuff. And it has five. Five letters.
Five petals. Dame, four letters. I think we beat that one to death.
Bad. Bad, bad, bad.
Takes after you. Naughty, naughty, naughty.
Now we're up in our little perennial garden here. This is a really cool plant. We planted this last year when it was in bloom. This is a great Indian plantain. It's a perennial. It's very sturdy. You can see these sturdy stalks. It really doesn't need a cage, I don't think, now that it's established. And it's going to have a beautiful flower bud. Once it opens, obviously, it's going to be white or pale yellow. These are giant bleeding hearts that just come up wherever they want them. And this is a forsythia. It was supposed to be a white forsythia, or no, a gold one. And it did actually have some flowers on it this year, so I was really happy. There's another one there. This is a hydrangea. Mm-hmm. It didn't get eaten by the
I love the
deer.
Thistle.
There's a thistle, and then there's all of these guys, these columbine that are moving in on my hydrangea. Mm-hmm. Another forsythia, right?
And this, do we know what this is?
I don't know what this is. No.
Feeling it looks like a weed.
I don't know, it looks like it's supposed to be there.
Okay.
And then there's this one, which says it is Queen of the Prairie.
We need to move that out further mm-hmm. so we can see the...
Now this does, I suppose it does kind of look like the other Queen of the Prairie we have, but those are cool leaves.
Looks like almost a three-leaf marijuana leaf.
It
instead
does.
Instead of five.
What have you been planting in here, mister?
Not me. I don't even smoke.
Husker's red. These seem more green than red, but and they have kind of moved around as far as I can
yes,
tell.
Yes, they have.
And I think this is rose mallow, which likes to plant itself everywhere. And here's your lamb's ear.
Yep.
Very nice. Very sweet and soft.
Mary had a little lamb.
And then beyond them is our vegetable garden, our north vegetable garden. These are our peppers, some hot, some sweet. They look very good. Behind them are the eggplants. And then to the left of them is all of our tomatoes.
And again, how many tomatoes did you put in this year?
was it, 46?
46, I think, and 23 varieties, right?
Mm-hmm.
Different varieties.
Mm-hmm. And then in that caged-in area, I am again going to try to do beets. Last time I tried to do beets, the deer ate off all the taps and we never got any. But I watered them this morning.
And this is where you put me when I'm a naughty boy?
If you're a beet.
Ah, well, just don't beat me.
We got beets in the back, carrots on the in the front, and over here we have cucumbers. So they're going to climb up.
Okay.
And you can see that we've planted our marigolds and our sweet alyssum, and they are all doing nicely.
And for those who maybe aren't familiar with why you would add flowers to your vegetable garden.
I'm attracting pollinators, not only to make it pretty, but to attract pollinators. They absolutely love sweet alyssum. And those pollinators will then come onto my tomatoes and pollinate my tomatoes, along with the bumblebees, and just give us a better crop of tomatoes. The marigolds, while some people think they keep rabbits away, which very well they might, they also add good nematodes to the soil. They attract the good ones and repel the bad ones.
So that's why you just kind of, you don't really get rid of them, you just tear them up and sprinkle them all over.
Yes, even after they're done with their life, they still have whatever it is that attracts the good nematodes.
I really like the ferns that you have over here. I think this is probably either this fall, might be a good time to start digging these up and dividing and starting putting over. There's a marker there too.
Yes, this is a Japanese painted fern. This has been here for years. We started with one little tiny piece. This is the north side of the garage, so it gets a lot of shade, like it should.
Oh, it's very prolific.
Yes, and very pretty.
And any water in your water barrels yet?
Yeah. There's some. This one definitely has more than this one. We're behind the garage now where we have our Liberty Garden, but we wanted to show you. This is the giant fleece plant, and you can see why they call it giant. It was in an area that it's been in for years, but it's ruining the bushes, the evergreen bushes behind it, because it gets so dense. And I wanted that area for putting in different perennials.
Well, so, I thought you were going to put that new apple tree there.
Possibly that too. So we needed to move this out of the way, but we didn't want to get rid of it. We're probably going to pot up some of them. Liberty Garden. My peas are coming up.
Yes, sir.
And they're going to crawl right up there. It's a little late for peas, but oh well. This is my poinsettia that I got for free at the plant sale. As soon as it looks like it's pretty much done here, I'm going to chop it down and plant it right in the soil. And we've been told that it'll start all over again. This is the popcorn we moved out of the garden area so we had room for an eggplant. I haven't quite decided what I'm doing with it. Maybe I'll just set it right there and let it go.
Yeah.
These are some of the plants that we started as seeds, and we're just letting them get bigger and stronger before we actually put them out in the garden. Again, those are coleus. These are also coleus, different kinds of coleus. These are coleus all along here. That was our rhubarb, our asparagus, which I'm going to be cutting these down to give the roots more power.
I'm amazed after having moved them this spring. We have had more asparagus this year than ever before.
Yeah. Yes. They were over here. We didn't need to have that much access to them because obviously you only eat them in the spring when they come up, but they didn't care that they were moved at all. Then these are...
morning glories?
No, they're sunflowers.
Oh.
Some of them are from Tim, and some of them are the ones that you had, Rick, that you bought. So it's amazing, you know, these were started at the same time.
Now, are these my Russian?
These are your Russian, yes.
Good grief.
I know.
Those are supposed to get like 16 feet tall.
And so are Tim's. So they're getting stronger and stronger, and I'm really pleased that nobody's eating them, insects or rabbits or whatever. So when I put them out in the garden, they're going to be tough and strong. A couple of days ago, we did a video about getting rid of anthills in your yard. And our technique that has worked the best for us is using water and just flooding them out. Many of you have said, well, you're really wasting water. It takes a lot of water to do that. And yes, it does. But we have a lot of visitors. We ourselves don't like to use chemicals if we can get away with not using any. So water is a safe way of getting rid of them. And we live, thank goodness, we live in an area where we're not having water shortages, and it's reasonable to use, so.
Or restrictions.
Right.
But here's that hill that was so large, and I mean, there is no activity.
Well, there's one.
Yeah, but those are the surface ones that
right.
are coming from elsewhere. But
yep.
you don't see new holes. You don't see anything coming back.
Nope.
I mean,
nope.
And the same thing was true over there where we had another mm-hmm. little one.
There's a little one here. That's totally gone.
Yep. And then we had one more that was right over here.
Smaller one. Yep.
But again, that's because we had the feeding source.
Right. They were after the compost. So I think what I'm going to do is take some of our dry compost leaves and put it in, add it in as the brown material to go with the green material. We've started planting permanent plants back here. This was an area where we had to remove bushes because it was going to be sided and they were far too close to the garage to get in there to do the siding. So we've added in some wigalias. And we'll be putting some perennials in here also. It's nice to see that we can again use this area. Again, when we were having the siding put on, we had to remove the bushes that were here, except for this poor thing, which I think we're gonna have to remove totally now. This is Little Princess Spirea. We bought them in 1-quart pots, same with those wigalias. They were teeny tiny. And we put these in first, because they finished with this and they are just going crazy. They are, I think, very happy right here.
I think so too.
Now this is the area where we took the giant fleece plant down, and you can see what it has done to the bushes behind it. Those are arborvitae, and they didn't like it. It was too close. So right in there I'm going to be able to plant some other things, maybe our apple tree. We have our little, what we call toadstool places to sit. And some of you may remember that there were ants attacking inside the, what is that, a 6x6?
Mm-hmm.
And, oh, there's one now. Let me get them. Flooding this with water would not have done anything because it's wood and it just goes down. So what we did was put taro ant poisoning on there. It seems to have taken care of it. I may have to give it another dose because I see one right there.
It's either that or it's still, it could be in the ground.
Yeah, true.
Just visiting.
True. So
but we bought some Bondo, wood filler.
Wood putty.
Wood putty.
Right. We bought some wood putty. Once we're sure that the ants are out of there, then we'll wood putty and then repaint. We are truly enjoying our picnic table already. We've been out here a couple of times. Now that the rain seems to be pretty much under control and it's getting a little warmer, it's a perfect place to eat our lunch.
Well, I saw you out here this afternoon reading.
Yes, well, maybe I was. Uh-huh. I was resting.
Well, I was working, right?
Mm-hmm. And you can hear the waterfall in the background, perhaps?
I like your little bench.
Thank you. That's the one we rescued from a garage sale. And then behind it is the climbing spinach. While it's not really spinach, it tastes like spinach. It's really good in a set in a sandwich or in a salad. And its climbing habit makes it just very pretty. And it gets these little flowers on it all summer long. And then sometimes the flowers even start new plants. Unfortunately, it's not a perennial, it's an annual. But I've kind of made this into my parsley spinach place.
Well, it does have a little tang to it.
It does, yep. We planted our pots, different bulbs coming up.
You planted pot?
Our pots.
You mean containers?
We planted our containers,
oh,
which
okay.
are sometimes
well,
called
Well, you have
pots.
To clear, in today's age, you have to clarify things because somebody might get the
well,
wrong
you
idea.
You talked about planting something up in the other garden.
Yeah, well, I didn't do that. So how tall will this get?
Well, this is one this is a canna that we started from a seed. So this year I don't think it's gonna get really tall, but as it matures each year and gets bigger and bigger, it'll get taller and taller. Hmm.
That's such a peaceful sound, isn't it?
Yes it is.
I think you need to turn the water off.
Oh, think we have enough in there?
Yep, I think we do. We noticed that lower pond was getting kind of low.
Right.
I think the water was evaporating.
Well, I have been stealing some through the water plant.
And I still never have gotten out here yet to level that overflow, that top level overflow, but I'll get to it one of these days.
Yep. And there are some bubbles here, but I think that it's still... working its way through its cycle of winter
oh.
and summer.
I also noticed that almost all of these are having the same issue. Now, this isn't a 6x6, so this is only a 4x4.
Right, yep.
So I think we're going to have to go through all of them and rebuild them.
It's just that the center pole, not so much the outer edge.
Right.
Something you learned.
I see what's opening over here, one of your poppies.
This is kind of a wild area at this moment. There were a lot of, what was in there? Oh, daffodils. There were a lot of daffodils in there. Now there are a lot of alliums in here. And I'm hoping that these are black-eyed Susans and not goldenrod. They're goldenrod, they're gone. The orange is, Russian wallflower, I believe, that we sprinkled wild seeds in here last year.
You know, I wish I would have gotten these sooner. These were absolutely gorgeous. These, again, are those Japanese fern leaf peonies, but these are double reds, and
yes.
they were magnificent.
Yes, they were.
Unfortunately, yep. I couldn't get out here in time. I think you did take a couple of pictures,
though.
I
did, and now I'll be cutting off most of the seed heads. So that, again, the energy can go back down into the roots for next year. I'll leave a couple just so I can get some seeds and maybe try to grow the seeds and see if we can propagate that way this year. Now, mind you, this is full sun. Why are these here, Richard? These ferns?
Are you blaming me for
putting
ferns here?
Yes, I am. And these are going to be a beautiful stargazer lily. This is the best I've seen that in
yeah.
a long time.
And the
long
Japanese
long yep.
iris?
Yep.
They're so delicate.
Again, we have another one of our containers with different bulbs coming up. These are also alliums. They're coming right up through this hosta plant. These are a different kind. They are lower to the ground, but they are huge once they bloom. And they do like to seed themselves in here.
I really like the texture of this hosta.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that is...
And from what we've heard, deer don't like to chew on these, and neither do slugs. They prefer the smooth skinned hostas. So if you have one that has a lot of texture, they will leave that alone if they can get to a smooth one. Now you see this one,
it's already covered your entire walkway.
Yes. Now, I guess it's really, really happy, but there comes a point once it stops flowering, that it will be cut down to like this much, and it will come right back next year.
And what are you going to have growing in your Grecian urn?
In my Grecian urn, I have a begonia, and then this is an asparagus fern that I wintered in the house, and it made it all the way through. It'll kind of drape. The begonia's in the middle.
And again, I have to thank Brian for his beautiful glass water sculpture.
Yep.
That was a pleasant surprise.
Now, as you can see, I have not weeded back here. This is a fragrant strawberry mixed with lipstick strawberry plant. So it's a hybrid, and we'll see if it actually gives us some edible strawberries.
And look what's blooming.
Finally, these are, I've always called them lemon lilies. I don't know if that's what they are or not. These are really late. They're at least 2 weeks late, because often they have they're almost done by Memorial Day. And this year we're going on, what is today, the 9th of June, so they're almost 2 weeks late. But we're just happy to see them. These are this golden zebra iris. Tough stuff, really tough. Doesn't seem to be bothered by the iris borer, the fact that it's in the shade. It'll have beautiful flowers on it. And now this, this is another blueberry. We ran out of space one year when we were doing blueberries. There's actually three of them in here. And this year decided it was going to blossom and produce blueberries.
And I think last but not least, we have to stop again and talk about what is in here.
I can smell them even though they're almost done.
Yep.
These were the tree peonies that we planted from seed probably 6 years ago now. This year more and more have blossomed. We had a couple of pale pink ones and a lot of white ones. Gorgeous, just gorgeous. Again, I'll be chopping most of the flower heads off. Always keep a few in here, as long as we're in here. Here we have more squash. This is where we have our delicatas, our butternut, and zucchini. We seem to be spending more and more time and space on nursery things. These were some escaped peonies that the seeds from these bigger guys fell on the ground.
Peonies.
Yes. And started growing all by themselves. So I've collected those that escaped and I put them in pots. These were the Japanese fern leaf peonies that I transplanted last year. Montauk daisies, snake willow. Our kale is over here in the shade, and our garlic.
Talk about dinosaur kale before we go over to the garlic.
Oh, dinosaur kale. Yeah. It's a beautiful, easy to wash, easy to use kale, and it gets sweeter and sweeter as it gets colder and colder. So it's a fun plant to grow. Our garlic is, I'm guessing, we'll probably be sending out its scapes soon.
Yep, it's over 2 foot tall.
Mm-hmm.
It's amazing.
We're going to end our part one of our early June garden tour here. Otherwise, it's going to get way too long. If you enjoyed it, please give us a thumbs up. We'd love to thank you all for watching and for all your lovely comments and questions and tips. And I'd like to say thank you, Phyllis.
Uh-huh. You keep getting all these nice little gifts in the mail. I got something from Tim today, too.
So thank you, Tim, also. See you soon for part two. Bye for now.
Connect with us on YouTube.